Okay, I'm back, and we're going to talk about deserts and desert plants. And one thing you must know about true deserts is that there's three things. You know, I'm looking at our textbook we use in our class for physical geography. It talks about the scarcity of water, the unreliability of water, and the intenseness of it. So what does that mean? It means basically there are places around the world, if you're an 18-year-old like the Atacama Desert, where you may have never seen rain. The frequency can be upwards of a decade or two. And then when it does rain, it's flash floods, it comes down intense like during the monsoon seasons in Arizona. So plants have to adapt to that, and those kinds of plants have a special name. They're called Xerophytic. Xerophytic, and that's X-E-R-O, phytic, P-H-Y-T-I-C, I believe, phytic. And this is a good example here, this type of cactus here. Notice it has spines to keep the animals and, you know, like birds and other terrestrial animals from eating it. It also has, and rather than leaves, it has this green skin that it must use to gather energy through the sun, photosynthesis. And it's also pretty bulbous. In other words, it can, once it does rain, let's say once a year, it can suck up all that water in one fell swoop and store it in the vessels of the plant here. So these plants have been around the desert for, you know, thousands, if not millions of years, whatever the time frame is for the climate there, and have really adapted to that harsh climate. So here's a map, and we can see the United States and Mexico, and then down in here we have Venezuela and Peru, the Atacama Desert's down here in South America. And the equator, let's use that as where air rises during the equinox, so when spring starts or when fall starts. And that's where air, or it could be even further down, let's say in the wintertime. But wherever the sun's directly overhead, air rises because it's super hot. And then it tends to come down about 30 degrees away, both sides. They are convection cells that circulate like a boiling pot of water, and they do descend, and that descending air, subsiding air, causes the deserts. Okay, it's air being compressed and heated as it sinks. We see a universal pattern around the world, particularly on the West Coast, by the way. The other things that can happen is these are cold ocean currents. So the California current is coming from the north. It's very cold and creates fog belts. But believe it or not, it does actually dry out the air. For example, down in Southern California and Baja, you know, we get fog on the coast, but it's extremely dry there. And another thing looking at the map here would be on the backside of the Sierra Nevadas, the westerlies bring in most of the moisture that comes from the north and west or the southwest, and these Sierra Nevadas act as really a barrier, a rain shadow. And so we get some deserts on the backsides there. All right, let's take a look at a different kind of map. We just saw a regular map with topography. We talked about the three different causes, and then I did show you some plants that would be typical. They're called xerophytic plants. Let's review the system, the Köppen climate system. So at the equator, we typically have an A climate, the tropical climates. There are different flavors. I'll talk about three different types. And then we have the deserts with the yellow here. That's the B, or the arid, dry climates. And then there's some other letters here I'll go over in just a sec. And then, of course, the C for the temperate climates, and then the D climates up there, let's say, in this case here, like in Russia. I'm taking a look at Africa because it has a nice profile here up into Europe. Okay, second letter here is the W. Those are the dry deserts. Notice it has an H here, so it could be hot, like in the Saharan Desert. There could be a K there, by the way, lowercase K for cult, and that's a cold desert like you might have in the Mojave Desert. In the Sonoran Desert, they typically are hot, and then there's kind of on the fringes, then you might have a colder desert there. And then also, just to add to this, the BS, which is down here on the fringes, those are the steppes where you start to see sagebrush, and you might see trees like the junipers we saw in Sedona. And so sometimes you're right on the edge, in other words. But these, in general, are very dry. And we're going to talk about evapotranspiration that helps kind of explain this aridity or this dryness. Hey, I've got a cool picture here of Havasupai Falls, and this is near the Grand Canyon. You can see this gorgeous waterfall with the turquoise, and I just want to add a little color to this chalk. Notice it gets real white on us and washed out. All right, so evapotranspiration is our last term here, and let's talk about evaporation. It's basically two words put together, evaporation and transpiration, which is what plants do when they breathe. So evapotranspiration. Evaporation, of course, is from water that's, let's say it's liquid like in a lake or an ocean, and then it evaporates into water, moisture, or vapor. And then the transpiration comes from the plants as well, particularly on land. A lot of the moisture comes from the plants, you know, whether it's the tropical climates or the deserts, you know, that those plants are also breathing off CO2 and water vapor. And so that's what that's all about, evapotranspiration. Think of it as sort of humidity in a way. And then if we take a look at potential evapotranspiration, this is how I explain the amount of rainfall deserts get, let's say, compared to like a sea climate, like in the, like I said, in the southeast of the United States where it's humid. That would be greater. So let's take a look here. So we would have precipitation would be, in deserts, would be less than evapo combined with transpiration. In other words, there's really, like, if we had 16 inches of rain, there's really not enough water to supply, like, these certain kinds of plants are limited. They've adapted to that, those dry conditions, because the air sucks up the water, and of course the plants suck up the water and then slowly breathe it back out. And so you're never going to see puddles. When it says less than, precipitation is less than evapotranspiration, it's going to be a dry, you know, you pick up the soil, it's not even moist, and that's typical of a desert, so those plants have to adapt to those dry conditions. If this, let's say, is now 36 inches, we're going to change that to 36. And that's kind of where I live here in Northern California. You know, we could have that equal to or greater than, because the amount, total amount of water that is sucked up by the air and the plants now exceeds essentially the capacity of the air and the plants. So you'll see like a puddle standing around here in the winter for sure, especially as I head up into Oregon and Washington where it's cooler and there's more moisture. That would be then a greater than. So I just want to conclude that potential evapotranspiration is important when we talk about these climate zones. And the net result is like that plant we saw outside, where it really has to adapt to these harsh desert climates.